I'm Alex Noonan. I'm a developer advocate here at Dagster Labs, and today I have another video in our series around Dagster Best Practices, where we show you tips and tricks that will help you get started and ship more confidently in Dagster. And today I'm going to cover a topic that is near and dear to my heart, which is how to do machine learning within Dagster. Now, machine learning has been around for a while, but a lot of people still suffer from how to take their notebook of their beautiful model that works perfectly on their computer and deploying it in some sort of production setting where it's on the cloud or their own infrastructure. Now, if you haven't read this book, I highly recommend you read Design Machine Learning Systems by Chip Huynh. She is a fantastic resource for all things ML, and she has a great blog too. But that book is extremely helpful in how to think about how to take your machine learning model and push it into production. Now, conventional wisdom states that about like 80 to 90% of ML or data science projects fail to deliver value. And this is caused by a few reasons, most notably a lack of resources, whether it's on the DevOps deployment side or whether it's on the data science side, because those are very like specialized fields. And it's kind of rare for companies to have the resources to do it all. And it's even more rare for organizations to have one person that can do all of those things. Two is machine learning models, sometimes when they interact with production data that are outside of their training scope, don't work that well. And three, lack of proper infrastructure and management. And that's what I'm going to focus on today. And from what we see at Dagster, when companies implement proper ML orchestration, they generally achieve 20 to 50% operational cost reduction and 2 to 10x faster deployment cycles. And today I'm going to go with the canonical example of the MNIST dataset, which you may be familiar with if you've done machine learning in the past. But it's a very simple example of labeling handwritten letters and numbers and creating a model that can predict those. And I'm going to incorporate some of the Dagster best practices around machine learning. So we're going to have data quality, we're going to have observability and monitoring, and we're going to have a deployment logic all within one project. And the link to this project is in the description, so you can check it out yourself. By the end of this video, you're going to have a better understanding of how to structure your ML pipelines using software-defined assets and flexible config, why asset-based thinking works well for machine learning, and how to implement proper testing and monitoring and deployment, and most importantly, how to ship your machine learning models with confidence instead of pushing and praying. So without further ado, let's get into it. All right, so right now I'm in the Dagster UI, and this is for the project that we're going to be looking at. And as you can see here, we have some data processing for the raw data. We have some model training, evaluation, and deploying to production. And then we also have our inference steps. And if you're new to Dagster, the global lineage view is one of my favorite features of our product. And it really is like the best way to see how your data platform is connected and how everything depends on each other. And now that we know what we're working with, let's take a look at the code. So here we are in Cursor. And the first thing I'm going to discuss is the project structure and layout here. So inside of our Dagster project, we have our PyProject TOML file, which we're working at here. And this is where you define all our dependencies and where your project's located. And I used UV for my Python package management and for this project. And if you haven't used UV yet, I highly recommend it. It's extremely fast and it takes away a lot of the complexity and headache that comes with managing Python projects, which if you've been around a little bit, you know, can be quite a bear. But inside our Dagster project, we have our actual like Dagster project here and our definitions in this folder. Whenever I'm coding in Dagster, I like to have each abstraction as their own Python name. And then if I have multiples of that abstractions, I throw them in a folder and that just keeps everything organized. And one thing that you'll know if you've done machine learning before is that there is a ton of specific dependencies that you need to use. And some of these dependencies can be conflicting with each other, especially if you're using different models with different Python versions, et cetera. So that's why we recommend if you have a machine learning pipeline to stick it in its own code location. That way you can manage your dependencies all within there so they're isolated from the rest of your data platform. And you can still get that global lineage and visibility into everything. Being able to experiment and iterate is very important for anything in the scientific domain, but you want to be able to replicate the same development experience, whether you want local or using production resources, which is like usually in the cloud. And to accommodate this, I am using resources to abstract away the storage and compute for local and production use cases. I recently did a video all about resources, and if you're curious about that, I encourage you to check it out. So the pickle file is the main thing that we want to be saved and retrieved, and that's where like the model weighting is stored. And I have this base resource here that will be used by both the local and the cloud storage. And that is basically saving the model, loading the model, and listing the model. So it's a pretty simple implementation. And then for the local one, we are just saving the model in this models folder. And then for the cloud one, we're going to do basically the same thing, but on S3. And this model is like relatively lightweight, so it's totally fine that I'm leveraging the compute on my MacBook. But if you're deploying this into production, and especially if you're using like a complex model, you're going to want to leverage GPU and cloud resources, so your performance and latency makes everybody happy. So I have this resource here for SageMaker, but for the purposes of this demo, I'm going to be doing everything locally. But what's nice about resources is your assets can stay the same whether you are developing locally or in production, and you just need to change the resources. So that separation of storage and compute from the actual logic in your assets is a really powerful abstraction and allows for that plug and play feel depending on your environment. So models are expensive to train and use for inference in production, and you want to have a data quality layer as part of your process to make sure everything works as intended and you can avoid some unwelcome surprises. So when we go to the asset graph here, we can see that we have asset checks for every step in the process to make sure everything works as expected and we don't have any messy data going throughout our pipeline. And these asset checks materialize whenever a asset runs. So let's take a look at some of these asset checks so you can get a sense for the types of things we check for. So in the assetchecks.py file, we have data quality checks for the raw data, and it's looking for asset completeness. And what's cool about asset checks is they're super flexible, so you can code any logic you want since it's just Python. So you can get really granular or just kind of generic. And I have asset checks here to make sure the data is the right structure, make sure nothing is missing. And data quality is an important part in building confidence in your pipelines. And you can even set up alerts to notify you when checks fail, so you can catch issues in production before your downstream stakeholders or data consumers do. And testing is a great example of one of those software engineering best practices that we're always talking about here at Dagster. And I have several tests here in the tests folder, aptly named. And I have some unit tests for specific components of the pipeline. I have integration tests for Dagster assets and mock data creation. And this is useful for CI/CD purposes. So you can have these tests run as a part of your PR merging process to ensure that the code will work in production and catch any breaking changes before it's merged into main. So we have tests for the data assets to make sure they exist, that we can test the full pipeline. And then we have the test model here to make sure that it loads and operates properly. So I'm gonna run these tests now and you can see what the output looks like. So all of these tests passed, and if you were really doing this in production, you would probably have a lot more tests and they would be a lot more specific. But for this example, I kept it simple so you can see how it all works together. And if you want to learn more about testing, we have a course dedicated to that all within Dagster University, and you can check it out here. And as it relates to assets, so probably the biggest thing that I want you to take away from this video, if you're using Dagster for ML or any sort of experimental assets, is using flexible configuration for assets. With ML, experimentation and iteration is super important, and asset configuration is the best way to enable data scientists and ML engineers to experiment with different model parameters in the training process, either locally or in production. And in this model config, it's basically a Pydantic class that just has all of the variables that we are going to use for this. And then we have another class here for the convoluted neural net, which takes in that config. And I'm not going to go into a ton of detail, As I mentioned earlier, machine learning code can be kind of hairy. And then looking at the digit classifier asset, which is the model training. So we're using that model configuration to parameterize our asset. So anytime we want to run a different experiment to see if we can increase the accuracy, speed up the training time, and we can do that all through the UI using Launchpad. So to simulate doing that in production, let's hop into the UI and launch a training run with a different configuration than we have set here. All right, so I'm in my asset lineage view. Let's go to the digit classifier. And in order to take advantage of the flexible config, I'm going to open Launchpad here. As you can see here for the config, we have a ton of parameters. I am going to adjust the epochs to 20 to make this train faster and decrease the batch size to 32 as well. And we'll also include the asset checks, and then we can materialize it here. And one of the best parts about Dagster is whenever you're looking at the run, you can input whatever logging you want. So we have all this metadata relating to our training parameters and really anything we want to put in here. And since you're focused on the asset, when you have an error in like a complex process of multi-asset materialization, you can go to the one that failed and you're only seeing the relevant context log for that. So that makes it a lot easier to troubleshoot and understand what went wrong and then fix it. Now that a model is finished training, we can take a look at the runtime metadata. We have each individual epoch training result. Yeah, and if you're wondering why the accuracy is so high, I took one of the best trainings from Kaggle and use that for the model parameters here. So now that the model has passed training, we're gonna do the evaluation step and then we're going to push it in production if it passes our threshold. All right, so looking at the metadata here for the evaluation, we can see that our test accuracy is very high. All our metrics are 99% or higher. And then we can look at our metadata plots here, which is really useful if you have multiple runs for different configurations. And then we are pushing this model into production. And then to do some inference, we materialize this model here. So we can look at the run for this. So we have the run and then the individual asset check. Everything is within the range we want. And then when you're putting this into production, you often won't be manually clicking things in the UI. So you can have Dagster jobs that automate different stages of the process. So you can put the entire deployment job into its own pipeline. And additionally, we have some sensors here, this one for the failure and this one for the schedule. And between all the observability, experimentation, and productionizing and automation, that really ties in all the elements of good ML ops and why Dagster is such a powerful choice if you are incorporating machine learning into your existing data platform. I hope you found this video helpful, and I look forward to seeing you in the next one.